COVID-19 epidemics. And when I discussed my talk with Joachim from Brain NTNU, he asks me, but are you sure that this is AI, this stuff that you're doing? And this is a fair question, Joachim. And I start with putting concepts in place. So this is my world of my look of into AI and data science. So it's intersecting statistics and mathematics with computer science, and then the substantive science or sector or area that you are concerned with, and that provides the data and provides the questions. And when you do this intersection, you find machine learning, bioinformatics, biostatistics, and in the middle, data science. And my talk is in here, in the middle there. Okay, and if you want to find out where AI is in my understanding of the world, then we need another bubble, which is engineering, and then we get AI in the middle with robotics. So the government also yesterday takes very important decisions for the country in order to control the pandemics. And we in Folkhälsoinstitutet, we have a precise task. And our task is to predict the number of infected individuals, which is called the incidence, predict the numbers of people who require hospitalization, in particular intensive care units. And to do this, we also will estimate the total number of infected so far, the prevalence, how many people got corona so far in Norway. And an important number and parameter that you all have heard about is the reproduction number, R. And this we have to estimate and predict at national level and at fylke level, at county level. And all this also in the light of the vaccination program that is start and in the light of the new variants of the virus that are coming into Norway. It's a difficult task, but we are helped by important data sets. Data sources. So the data sources that exists are at municipality level, 356 in Norway, and it's the total number of people tested and the total number of those who are positive every day, the total of imported cases from abroad that are not infected in Norway, and the total of new admission to hospital because of the COVID-19. There are also other type of data that we are not using, the ICU admission and the total deaths. And then there is an important other source of data that we find very useful, and it's the description of how people move in Norway, because moving means that you take the virus from one place to another. Let me try to say, first of all, that it is really, really important to understand the origin of data. And an important task in artificial intelligence and in everything what we're doing is to understand every single data point, what it really means and what information it contains. For example, here you see a plot of the negative tested. It's the blue one. You see the positive tested down there, the red one, and you see the percentage tested per week. And these are all important things. The number of positive tested is important, the absolute number, because in Oslo today we have so many, for example, that the contact tracing can be delayed, which is a problem. But the percentage is really telling us something really fundamentally, because of course we find positives if we test more. So there is a connection between the positive tested and the total tested. So for example, you can easily find in the press articles that say that the number of corona smitted in Oslo has triplicated the last week. And when we look to the percentages, we see that it has been a factor 5, for example. And this is understanding the fundamental information in data. It's simple things, right? But it's important. So here you see another piece of data. This is the number of tested from the beginning of the epidemics divided into the ones that have been tested for the first time and the ones that are tested multiply. I think that today a lot of people get 2, 3, 4 tests if they are in quarantine, for example. And of course, we have to count only one because these are repetition that don't tell us much more. So we have to split the number of tests in these various components. Only then they become informative for the purpose of describing how the epidemics develops in our country. The mobility that we have in our models is captured by the mobility of mobile phones. Telenor, that has a market share of about half of Norway, provides us with mobility data that tells us where the mobile phones are and where they move every 6 hours between municipalities. So the data are, in these 6 hours, 356 people moved from Trondheim to Oslo and so on, among all these 356 municipalities. A nice matrix every 6 hours. And because of privacy, if the counts go below 20, they're censored. And these data are in itself very interesting. So here you see the data from March until a week ago. It's the number of movements out from the main cities in Norway. I think the red one is in fact Oslo. What you see is that an enormous drop in mobility after the first lockdown in March. And then here's the summer and the vacation. People move. Lots of people went to Tromsø because they couldn't go to Mallorca. And here you see something very interesting. Here you see in December, the first week of December, a dramatic increase in movements that is connected to shopping and to fill up shops with things that people should buy. And here is where we are. You see, we are quite, we are lower than before, but we are quite high. And Trondheim is completely in the middle here. Then we take the 5 million people that live in Norway and put them in their municipalities. And this is where they live, and this is where they start, and this is where they move from and go back, according to the description that the Telenor data will give us, not individually, but as a population. But here there is, again, thinking to data, students are a problem because students are living in Trondheim, but they are resident in with their families very often. And so if you get sick in Trondheim, you will still be counted in Oslo if you're coming from there. So difficulties and inconsistencies that are important to remember. If XIJT is the matrix that tells us how many people moved from commune I to commune J at time T between T and T minus one. So this is this beautiful matrix. Because you in principle conserve people, they don't disappear, there is no exit from the system, then this equation that you read there must be true for every time point and every IJ. But it is not true. It is not true because people escape the Telenor data, because the phones are off, they don't work, they are not connected, you do things that are different than expected, and these errors in this equality, they're problematic, because suddenly you can start to deplete smaller municipalities because you want to move people out from the municipalities and there's nothing there. So you have to regularize these matrices. You have to do so that you preserve populations. And then you do some mathematics and understand that this means that the rows of the sums and the rows of the columns should be the same. And then you find, by doing some quadratic programming with linear constraints, you find the matrices that are closest to the one that you get from Telenor, but preserve the population. These are the ones that we use for mobility. Then we have to describe by mathematically how the infection happens in the country. And these are these famous SARE model. There are very many, everybody uses them now, those who do modeling of the epidemics. They have compartments, and people are susceptible in the beginning, and then they can be exposed, they get infected, but they're not infectious. Some will remain asymptomatic all the time. It goes here on this side. Some become symptomatic on this side here. And when you're asymptomatic, you can still infect the others, but this happens much less. And there are lots of probabilities and parameters that we have to describe in this model to start to understand how it works. Imagine a simulation code that will describe and simulate the trajectory of the epidemics in Norway until today. For example, we need to know how much time people remain in exposed but non-infectious. What is the probability if you become infected that you're asymptomatic or symptomatic? This probability is today fixed to be 40%. Comes from the literature, but a couple of days ago, we understand that it should be really 30% because more knowledge is there. We should change it, right? And when you are asymptomatic, then you are infectious. Yes, you are, but only 10% of what you are if you are symptomatic. And then there is this very famous and crucial parameter beta, which is called the reproduction number, essentially, which is the probability that you you transmit your infection if you are infected to other people, and R is the number of that you infect. Differential equations, stochastic differential equations, govern how the dynamics and the disease is modeled. They're very simple. They can be solved easily. And then I have to add pieces of information. So how do I send my people to hospital? Because I will need to send in my simulation, I will need to hospitalize people, because only in this way I can compare my model with the data about the hospitalization. The data of the hospitalization is here. I want a model that produces hospitalization that are similar to the data. This is called often calibration or inference. And I need a model here. And then I need also a model that says how long people stay in hospital. Well, okay, how much time does it take from symptom onset to hospital? We find out by looking to the very strong and very good Norwegian registries that this takes about 7.6 days with a certain distribution and negative binomial. And if you go to hospital, what is the danger that you need ICU? It's described here. It's not much, right? But it's here. And then if you are in this line, it takes more time in hospital and so on. Then I need, in order to compare our simulation with the test data, I need to say who is going to be tested and who is going to be found tested. So I will have to model the probability to detect a positive case, pi t. And this pi t is a logistic model that says at time t, this is a certain fixed factor plus something that depends on the number of tests actually performed on day t. Because if you perform a lot of tests, then there will be higher probability to detect a positive person, and so on. So these are important points. Then we can't estimate this beta tf easily. It's a number different for every fylke and for every day. So the first model that we run simplifies the situation by saying that, okay, we are not going to change every day. We change it in chunks. So here between in this period of the year, we have one number for every fylke. Here we have another number and so on. These are called change points. And we put them in the right places. We put them when the government makes decision, because then we can imagine that these transition probabilities change. And here are the results that we got today. So you see for whole Norway, this is results for the whole country. The current change point is put on the 2nd of March, a couple of weeks ago, and the estimate of the reproduction number is 1.3 with a confidence interval or a Bayesian credibility interval. This is Bayesian, in fact, 1.2, 1.5. This is an estimate of the reproduction number changing every day, which is also something that we do by using something called sequential Monte Carlo. You see here that in the last days, we see a small drop. This is a really important thing, because it could well be that the intervention in Oslo in March have produced an improvement and in Viken have produced an improvement. We don't know it. Yes, there is uncertainty, of course. Here you see the numbers in the rest of the country. Trøndelag, where is it? Here you see Trøndelag has quite a big uncertainty. It's between 0 and 1.2, something like that. The median is 0.7, but it's lower than a lot of other fylkes. And this is, of course, good. Predictions. Here we have the data points are the red dots here. This is the new admissions to hospital. It's going down. It's going up here again. And this is our prediction here, what will happen the next 3 weeks. I'll conclude now. I have 1 minute, I hope, 2 minutes, by trying to summarize where are we with this science that you're doing, and maybe also with artificial intelligence in this period of emergency. And I'll go back to the UK, Boris Johnson, on the 12th of March, press conference. He said, it is inevitable that most people will get the disease. So we should let the epidemic proceed to allow 60% of the population to become infected and build herd immunity. 3 days after, on the 16th of March, a very famous epidemiologist and statistician, Neil Ferguson from Imperial College and his colleagues, they produce what is famously called the Report 9, which studies what is the impact of doing or not doing things in a country on mortality. And this is a stochastic model, very similar to the one that I showed you now. And the result of his work on that day is that if you do nothing, then 500,000 people will die in the UK. If you do a lot, only 20,000 people will die. And a couple of days after, the Ministry of Health in the UK, he says, keeping the total number of COVID-19 deaths under 20,000 would be a good outcome. And a couple of days after, the UK is in lockdown. Science has an enormous impact, but science is still, in this phase, quite imprecise. This famous report 9 has been changed and corrected and corrected and discussed. And also our work, which has been important on the 12th of March, for example, but also yesterday, when the important decisions were taken, this piece of work has changed and changed and changed. And we have produced an update note that has now 8 pages that contains all the changes and all the corrections that we have done to our models, because we understand more and we understand better. Science is changing. It's moving from being evidence-based, which means that as a scientist, you take all the available knowledge that you have now and all the available data, and you produce results that are final in the current situation. This is what it has been so far, but it's not like this. I'd like to call this evidence-making science. Models are just starting points and not the final truth. Models change and methods change on the basis of knowledge that is changes and also needs. And the public, you are influencing us what we do. And uncertainty is so big that results really only open playgrounds where decision and discussion can take place. And these playgrounds are really, really important because data allow you to move here freely and use other type of politically, ethical, economical arguments. What about artificial intelligence in emergency? Think to what is happening with AstraZeneca. And I ask you, and here these are more questions than answers. Could a monitoring algorithm recognize the clusters of strange cases more rapidly and more better than, for example, what has happened in the UK, where I've been waiting for weeks to understand if there are clusters there? But if there is such an algorithm, would the public trust this algorithm? And even more, how would we test it outside the pandemic? Where would we test it? How could we do it properly? And another important point is that when you are in emergency, you don't have time to do things well. There is no time to collect and curate a large training data set to run your deep learning. You don't have the time. There's even no time to test and debug your code properly. So how do you communicate to the public that your results might be in fact wrong and tomorrow I'm going to change them? These are all questions and we try to answer them. And if you want to work together with these nice people, then you can email me and try to help us to answer them. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Arnoldo. We have a question here for you. And the question is as follows. What are your expectations of the number of infected by the virus after Easter?
So I think that the situation now is quite bad. 1.3 means that everything is increasing. So in the next 3 weeks, the situation is going to be worse in hospitals. This famous UK variant, the B117, is completely predominant in Oslo, but not in other places in Norway. So it's still growing. And this comes with an increase of the R number, because it is more aggressive. So I imagine that the situation is going to be worse. But on the other hand, we have all these interventions, social distancing, 2 meters instead of 1 meters, and so on. Very good and important aspects that will, on the other hand, reduce things. So I think that I want to be a bit optimistic and imagine that we will see better situation in 3-4 weeks. Maybe in 5 weeks, we will have an R number that is maybe 1.1, 1.2, and vaccination is going up. And these two things together, they allow us to have a summer, I think. And normal classes in Trondheim from 15th of August.
Let's hope so. Thank you so much. Our next speaker is Thomas Lange. Thomas, the floor is yours.